situational point of view, but actually a personal point of view, emotional point of view, you're going to have to think twice, or three times, or five times, because it's very, very complex. And this is where, in my opinion, every roadmap for kind of a B2C company really should be targeting. So how do we achieve emotional relevance on a one-to-one scale? With the technologies that we have today, that's possible. We can define how I'm going to be reacting emotionally to different marketing messages, and we can design communication to actually reach me with that one-to-one targeting. So we should be doing that. And that, of course, has implications on how we design our messages, how we set up our technology, and as we're going to hear from Mula, how we set up the kind of backbone and the analytics that should be driving that. The other thing is around innovation. So what we see in a lot of roadmaps is that most of the focus for the coming 3 years are really about reaching a hygiene level. So you're a lot about, you know, implementing technologies, putting a strategy in place, becoming personalized, omnichannel is in there, segmentations, stuff like this. And it's really kind of just hygiene level stuff. You need that stuff in order to survive in the market, but it's never gonna set you apart from your competition. If you're in a highly competed market, that can never be enough. So if you're in charge of marketing or CRM or customer experience, if you're setting your bar at being at least as good as the others, then that's not enough by any means. So the stuff that really is then kind of gonna contribute to your market positioning and your competitive advantage, your competitive edge, it's the stuff that comes after the hygiene stuff. And these are kind of some of the stuff that we're thinking about a lot right now. So a lot of thinking goes into machine learning, AI. How do you build stuff that learns from what happens? How do you build self-optimizing campaigns? How do you spend less money on stupid things and more money on the good things? Recommendation engines. We're even thinking a lot about blockchain, which really, really will have a significant change in how we manage our customers. Not next year, not in three, but in 5 years, that's going to be a huge thing. So in order to be able to think about these things, you have to have the hygiene in place. And in order to get there, you also have to be able to kind of set up a business case for that. So that's kind of the last reason why the why is not good enough. So we're not attaching our roadmaps to visions that have a clear business case. I quite often talk about metrics myopia. That means short-sightedness. So you're actually only looking at the metrics that you can measure in the short term. You follow up on campaigns on the sales results in the next month or two, instead of looking, for example, at the development of your customer lifetime value over time by doing these certain campaigns. Or you're only looking at short-term gains from doing activation campaigns and not measuring, for example, the long-term gains of emotionally connected customers, which is difficult and tricky to measure, but that should be kind of how you set up your roadmap. So to conclude the kind of why section, I just kind of wrote down some things that I think I see often being the 3-year targets, but which should be the 1-year targets. So those are things like the ability to reach your customers omnichannel, the ability to measure your marketing activities, having KPIs for it, ability to track the interaction with your customers across any channel. Those are easy things to do. It's just a matter of setting up the technologies and having it in place. Being able to personalize your customer experience and creating a coherent customer experience in different channels. Those are things for your first year roadmap. And then we're looking at the 3-year targets. Those are the tricky ones. Those are the ones where you're going to have to gather your team, make people work together. You're going to have to be cross-competent. You're going to have to work with IT, marketing, a lot of analytics, to really kind of think of how do we position ourselves in the market in the long term. What are those kind of innovation bubbles where we need to succeed to provide a significantly different customer experience? How do we design our marketing so that it becomes a service and it's not only, you know, spamming people, yelling at them, stuff that they don't want to hear? A really tricky 3-year thing that I think that all B2C companies need to do is to figure out how you pull CRM and marketing together. If they're separate organizations, that cannot be the case in 3 years. And it's kind of a tricky, politically flammable, super hard thing to kind of add to your roadmap, but you have to add it. Emotionally connected customers through the one-to-one experience, and then kind of having a kind of significantly transformed marketing organization with completely new setup, new organization, new processes, new way of working. So those are kind of good three-year targets from my point of view. And then I want to talk a little bit about what you put into your roadmap. Does anyone know about bike shedding? I think this is a fantastic, great topic. You should all bring it into your organizations because it's your best weapon against talking about unnecessary things. So bike shedding is a term which a guy called Parkinson brought into the awareness, and it's used a lot, especially in the software development community. And what it's about a fictional board meeting. And in this fictional board meeting, there's three agenda points. So the first agenda point is kind of agreeing on building a nuclear power reactor, $10 million of work. This is kind of from a pretty old book. The second agenda point is the proposal to build kind of a bike shed outside the nuclear power reactor, 350 pound actually. Kind of investment decision, and the last one is around what kind of coffee there should be at, you know, the site. And the amount of time spent for each of these topics is kind of inverse with the complexity. So on making a decision that is really difficult, that most people have a very difficult time grasping, we typically make those decisions really easily and fast. And on the topic of, for example, the bike shed, in this kind of fictionary tale, the people are using 45 minutes to talk about whether it should be aluminum or whether it should be some other material and what color it should be. And with the coffee, they actually don't even reach a conclusion because everybody has so many opinions about it. And in the software community, bike shedding is used as this kind of, you know, red flag card. So you can say that, you know, if people start talking about the coffee stuff, like the stuff that everybody has opinion on, then you're allowed to say, hey, you're bike shedding. And then you can kind of facilitate the topic of actually talking about the stuff that matters. So we should, of course, be talking about the nuclear power plant and how that's going to be built, not about the coffee. But there's kind of a very human tendency to do this. And I think bike shedding is the absolutely best way to kind of think about this, to ensure that we actually, in our roadmap, don't put bike shedding stuff. So bike shedding topics for your roadmap are things that actually should take less than a week to decide on, and then you should be done with it. Then you should be moving on to the stuff that's really hard. So bike shedding topics are, for example, tool selections. People love to talk about email editors. Stop talking about those things. It doesn't matter what kind of usability an email editor has in some software tool. Using 9 months to do kind of a sourcing process for setting up some technology that could be saving you, you know, millions per month. So it's a really, really difficult and or a stupid thing to do, to do waste time on tool and technology selection, where most of them, you know, if you pick one in the Gartner kind of top corner, it's going to work. It's not going to fail you. You're going to reach your business targets. So stop using time on those kinds of things. Channel selections, KPI selections, customer journey definitions, it's another kind of favorite time waster, I think. Everybody can kind of go into a workshop and think about how does it feel when I go into the store and then I get a mobile push and then I get an email. And, you know, it's not that hard. We can all probably figure it out very quickly. So we shouldn't be using our time indefinitely on defining customer journeys or customer experiences. We should create something that's minimum viable, and then we should go into kind of developing that further. GDPR is another favorite. Lots of time being placed in that. There is a very clear solution for how you handle your GDPR stuff. Let's get on to it. So the really kind of hard topics that you should be, you know, using the time on. So one is, for example, how do you set up this kind of scalable one-to-one customer experience, because it has a lot of implications on how you do your creative work. It has a lot of implications on how you do your analytics work. It has a lot of implications on how you do your technology, and also on how you do your customer strategy. So that's kind of a difficult question that you should be thinking about and using Climb for. The other one I've already mentioned, which is the ownership question. So who should actually be able to decide what the customer experience should look like, and how do you manage that kind of ownership? The organization designs and core processes, they are also kind of hard topics where you need to use the time. The technology strategy should enable you to not bike shed on those tool selections. So if you, for example, have a platform strategy, so you're going to go all in Salesforce, you're going to go all in Adobe, you're going to go all in open source, whatever it is, like if you have made those decisions once, then you don't have to use 9 months for every tool selection process that you have. The data and analytics backbone, Ola is going to talk about that. Measurement, how do you actually keep people accountable for the decisions they do? Not only set up KPIs, anyone can kind of set up the KPIs, but how do you actually measure and track and keep people accountable for those results? We should see a lot more people being fired from marketing from not reaching the results that they are accountable for, and we don't see that today. In the US last year, in the top 50 retail organizations, half of all CMOs got fired. That's really crazy. It's kind of really different from how we are managing marketing here. I'm not saying that it's a kind of a healthy culture, but it really kind of goes to show, you know, the accountability, and I think we're lacking some of that here. The partnership strategy and the partnership ecosystem is also kind of a big, big problem for most organizations. You find yourself in a spaghetti of agencies and different sub-optimizing processes. Somebody is saying that, you know, search and Google is the most important part. Somebody is saying that the creative part is the most important. Somebody is saying that service design and how it feels when you go into a store is the most important part. They're all important, but if you have different kind of partners dragging you in different directions, you're never going to be able to make smart and wise decisions. So you have to think about how you kind of set it up for solving those hard topics. And last but not least, how do you create capabilities in-house? We're going towards a trend where in-house capabilities and stuff that typically your agencies would have done for you is really kind of the big trend. So how do you make your own organization, for example, better at buying media than your own media agency? It's not that hard because they usually suck, I mean, it's still a question of how do you set that up? You're not used to that. You don't have that capability in-house. You need the new people, you need some tools, and you need to figure out how that fits into the big picture. The last part is the how. So once you've kind of figured out what you want to have in your roadmap and what your end state is, it's not going to be that easy. So you can kind of assume that the three-year roadmap really is dead, because you cannot know what's happening in 3 years. 3 years ago, nobody was talking about DMPs, for instance. And today, it's probably in most kind of decision-making stacks of larger organizations. We simply do not know what happens in 3 years. So it might be super tricky to kind of go through that process. And it's very, very likely that you're kind of gonna take some wrong turns on your kind of road. So that has to be an assumption. You have to kind of plan your roadmap for this will not work out as we thought it will. And you will face some kind of rocks in the road. You hope that those rocks aren't your boss or aren't yourself or your organization. Kind of that would maybe be a good assumption to start with, but there's going to be situations like this. You know, the data was not available, so we could not set up our one-to-one experience. Or we had this big event coming up, which forced us to focus all of our efforts on that event or product launch or whatever. So you have to be agile around this. And kind of agile strategy execution is really the way to go. So setting up these PowerPoints with these boxes, arrows that are following on different streams, you shouldn't do that because you are not able to define how the future will look. So instead, what kind of we really speak about is creating must-win battles instead. So must-win battles are themes that kind of connect your organization around kind of targets where you just cannot fail. And then you can have the mandate to really do what needs to be done to solve those kind of critical problems or critical issues. the picture is kind of trying to illustrate this, because the way that the US Army is battling ISIS and other kind of small terrorist organizations has really drastically had to change, because they are so agile. They cannot make a year-long plan of how they will innovate someplace where they know that yesterday terrorist soldier entity was being hidden, because they change every day. So they have to kind of reform kind of small groups that have all of the different competences you might need. And the same thing goes with marketing. So we have to kind of form around a really new way of working. You kind of forget about the waterfall strategy. Forget about the timelines and the milestones that are really set. Forget about project budgeting. I think the biggest problem, I think most of you probably talk about you want to be more agile, and then you go into your sourcing organization and say that we're gonna do this project agile, and then the sourcing organization go and talk to your partners and they say, you know, there needs to be a fixed price with fixed deliverables and timelines and milestones, and that's, you know, how this is gonna run. So you kind of basically sabotage all of that, you know, really from the start. Plans and documents, step by step, a lot of planning and talking and documenting before you actually do anything. You know, you can't have any of that. That's what leads to the 70% failure. So even a kind of agile strategy execution, my recommendation would be instead to form around kind of must-win battles, identify key kind of means and activities that you do within those must-win battles. Of course, we're going to have to form around some kind of timelines and some kind of milestones. That's not the case that we could kind of just tell the rest of the organization to bog off and let us do our own stuff. But you know, try to find a better way to do agile strategy. And the strategy also needs to live. So you have to have a process where you're actually updating it all the time. So for instance, every quarter. You should be budgeting for resources, not for projects. So a fixed project budget does not really incentivize you to do smart things. It only incentivizes you and your partners to use up all of that time and then likely a little bit more. So if you find ways of actually creating the incentives based on something else than a fixed budget and a fixed timeline, then you're going to be much more successful. You're going to be able to launch things much quicker. And you're going to be able to go live much quicker with things. So having this kind of minimum viable approach, testing stuff in practice instead. Talking and action at the same time. And then I think that the really kind of last thing is really about leadership. Because you can't do a roadmap and just expect it to happen. It's really about leading the people, especially in a transformation. So you cannot really emphasize the need for strong leadership enough. And that's, I think, where we all need to kind of look ourselves in the mirror and think about, what am I doing to lead this organization towards the target state, towards the why? So, to summarize, higher ambition. Oh, some animations. So higher ambition, going beyond the omni-channel kind of target state that we're all talking about right now, to create emotionally connected customers. That's really kind of the key. Try not to bike shed. Take that with you into your organizations. It works like a charm. And then being agile with your execution strategy. Do this and you will not fail. All right, that was all for me. Thank you.